Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to lecture number 15 of Software Requirements Engineering, CSE 305. We will continue our discussion on elaboration process in today's lecture as well. And if you guys remember, we started talking about software requirements engineering in the introduction, and then we talked about some software engineering tasks. But later on, we said that these tasks are too detailed, and we can call them, they are processes on its own. So we started with inception process, we then moved to the elicitation process, and we studied different techniques of eliciting software requirements, and then we moved to the analysis phase, or the elaboration process. And the purpose of the elaboration process is to develop an understanding about software requirements. And we basically said that there are three things we are interested in as requirement analyst. We want to understand the behavior of the system, we want to know more about the information domain, and we want to understand the functionality of the system that we are going to develop. And we do this analysis and elaboration because we want to build something which is acceptable by the client, and we want to satisfy the client. So we want to remove any ambiguities, any kind of problems that we might have in the requirements that we have elicited in the earlier phase. So let's quickly recap what we did in our last lecture. We were talking about object-oriented analysis or object-oriented approach of analysis or for elaborating requirements. And in our previous lectures, we have already covered two. So we have done the object-oriented analysis, the second was class modeling, and the third one was this behavioral modeling, which we did in our last lecture. And just to quickly recap, what was scenario-based modeling? It was, we tried to understand the system, we tried to analyze the system from user's perspective, that how a user is going to interact with my system and how my system is going to behave then. And similarly, then we said, okay, we have understand from the user point of view that how my system is going to behave and how, what kind of services my system should have for the end users. But we also want to understand about information domain. So what we do is we try to identify classes in class modeling. So that's the first thing that we try to do. We try to identify domain classes, and we do it by doing grammatical parse. Then we try to identify attributes and operation of these classes. So once we have individual classes, then we try to associate these different classes together. And for that, we can use class responsibility collaborator modeling. So we briefly looked at that as well. But then we said that, okay, we have done this class-based modeling, and through this class-based modeling, we have developed some understanding about the information domain because we have identified some information domain classes. We have also understood some sort of functionality because we have identified operations of these classes, and we have understand some behavior of these classes because when these operations would be applied on those attributes, then it gives us an insight into the behavior of this class. But we do not understand completely how this class is going to behave. And as we said, that the third important thing as a requirement engineer that we are interested in is understanding the behavior of the system. So this is really important. And for that, we do this behavioral modeling. And it gives us, as an analyst, deep insight into how my classes are going to behave, how my classes are going to behave on their own, and how my system is going to behave, because the system is a combination of those different classes talking to each other to complete certain requests or to respond to certain events by the user. So there are two kind of diagrams that we looked at in behavioral modeling. Number one was the state diagram. So within behavioral modeling, we looked at this state diagram, and we also looked at the system sequence diagram. And it is important to distinguish between the two. The state diagram is there to understand the behavior of one class. So for example, let's say we have five classes. So let's say we have these two classes in my system, class A, and we have another class, class B. And I want to know that what states would my class be in once, depending on different kind of triggers and depending on different kind of events. So normally how a state diagram is drawn, that you would always have a filled circle which actually shows the starting state, and it shows the starting event. So I would say that this is state one of my, so I'm trying to draw state diagram of class A. So this is an event. So we say that this is an event 1, which means, or this is the initial event, which whenever that happens, the class would be in state 1. And when the class is in state 1, another event happens, and the class goes to another state, which is state 2. And then depending on another event, it goes to state 3. And if there is some, so there is another possibility of another event. So basically what we have in state diagram is we have an initiating event, which means that the class would be in an initial state. And then based on that initial state, if there is any other trigger when the class is in a certain state, class may move to a new state. So what is a state? It is important to understand. So a state is values of attributes of a class. Right? So whenever an event occurs, those values are changed and the class goes to a new state. Right? So this is to develop the understanding about the behavior of one class. Okay. So we are saying that as an analyst, I now know that how my class is going to behave upon certain events. But I also want to understand the behavior of overall system. And for that, we have these system sequence diagrams. And one thing that I think you guys already know, but I just want to rephrase that, that when we say system sequence diagram, then it does not mean that for the whole system, we are going to make one diagram. So there can be multiple system sequence diagram for one software that you are making. So what do we have in system sequence diagram? We try to identify sequences of events. So for an initiating event, we try to identify that how my different classes are going to talk to each other, or how my class is going to interact with each other to respond to this event by the initiator object or by the end user. So what do we have in a sequence diagram is that we have an initiator object, so we call it an actor. Now this actor is responsible for initiating an event. Whenever this actor initiates an event, for example, let's take this example of class A and class B. So let's say this was the initiator event, and based on that initiator event, my class A was moved to this state 1. But then when it goes to state 2, it also needs to talk to class B to complete something. And so it talks to class B, and class B tells it something else, and then it goes to state 3, or it goes to state 1. So a system sequence diagram is, it has lanes. And remember another diagram which we covered in the scenario-based modeling, the swim lane diagram, it also has lanes. But in the swim lane diagram, the lanes, they belong to the actors. Whereas in a system sequence diagram, these lanes they belong to the classes or the instance of the classes. So we want to know the behavior of my classes or how my classes are going to behave when a user is initiating a particular event or starting a particular event. And so that is why if we want to know the behavior of one class, we try to draw state diagrams, and they give us an insight about the behavior of one class. But when we want to know, and as we said when we were discussing class modeling, that a class standalone cannot do all the cannot fulfill all the responsibilities that it has to. It needs to collaborate with other classes. And so for a certain event, if there is any interaction that a class might have with another class, we can show that through these system sequence diagrams, and it helps us in understanding the behavior of the system. So we have seen that applying object-oriented approach for analysis or for elaborating requirements is very helpful, because it helps us in identifying information domain, it helps us in understanding the functionality of the system, and it helps us in gaining better knowledge about the behavior of my system based on different events from the user and internal representation of the overall system. So that is what we have done so far in analysis, and we said that there are two main approaches for analysis. We have covered the object-oriented approach, and in today's lecture we are going to talk about the structured approach or the structured analysis, which there is one main technique that we use when we talk about the structured analysis, and that is flow-oriented modeling. Okay, and in our initial introductory lecture on these two techniques, we said that what is flow-oriented modeling and what do we mean by flow. So flow is, when we talk about flow, then what kind of flow we are talking about? So this flow is the flow of data through the system. And so what do we mean here is that, let's say this is my system, okay? This is a system that I'm making for the client. And when I say flow-oriented modeling, then this is the definition of software programs which I really like, and I even ask my students when new undergraduate students that how do you define a computer software or a computer system, and they give different definitions of this particular term. But to me, this definition makes a lot more sense, that you give certain input to a software and it transforms it in a certain fashion, which is intelligent as well, and it transformed it into an output. So, and this is obviously some intelligence it is involved there. So, and but as a requirement analyst, you know, I have gathered some scenarios. So again, remember that why we are talking about this flow-oriented modeling at this stage, because we are trying to put ourselves in the requirement analyst shoes, and we're trying to understand that how as an analyst, you are going to gain more understanding about the system. And the scenarios that user has told us, it has lots of information about what kind of inputs a user would give to the system and what kind of output it expects. And it also has some information that how this input would be transformed into output, but there is no structure to this information, that in what order these things are going to happen or in what hierarchy level these things are going to happen. So what we do is this flow-oriented modeling, it gives structure to, you know, all that argument. That, you know, we have lots of information that, you know, for example, a user is going to pass his login information, he is going to request for certain reports, or he wants output in the form of certain reports. So we know that there are certain inputs, we know there are certain outputs, and we also know there are some processes being applied on these inputs, and these processes change those inputs to outputs. So, but there is no structure to it. We don't know that in what hierarchy or to which particular section this process belongs to. And to achieve that, we do this flow-oriented modeling. And one of the most common diagrams that is made that is used is these are data flow diagrams. And mainly in the structured analysis, we are going to talk about DFTs, and it is one of the most used diagrams in software engineering across multiple platforms. Lots of people working in software industry, they actually deploy them as well. And making a good DFD is really difficult, because when you want to identify all the flows you want to go to the appropriate level of detail, that's not an easy task. So we are going to discuss DFDs and how we gain understanding about the requirements that we have gathered. But very quickly, we are going to talk about some rules and some basic definitions of DFDs, and where does it come from, and what is a DFD. So let's see. So again, we are talking about flow-oriented modeling. So what is a data flow diagram? It is known as DFDs. Commonly, you know, people would say DFDs, so it's understandable. These are data flow diagrams. It is a way to model a real-world situation. They are the interface between the real-world activities and an understanding of how this can be converted into a computer system. Okay. Now, this is an important statement, that we have some real-world processes or the current processes of the organization that we have understood or that we have gathered during the elicitation process. Now, we want this to convert into a computer system. Now, let's say everything in a certain university where you are going to, for which you are going to develop a learning management system is paper-based. And you have seen all those processes happening. They do registration on paper, they upload attendance on paper, they basically prepare the results on sheets. But now they want all these to be computerized. And so you want to understand those activities and you want to put them into a computer system. So it helps us, it creates an interface between these two things, that how we are going to actually do that. So why do we use DFDs? It is a way of taking the physical view and converting it into a logical view. As I just said, that we have those real world activities and we want DFDs, they provide us an interface to converting them into a computer system. So what are these physical views? So for example, in terms of this requirement engineering process, what these physical views, they are basically everything that we have gathered from the end users. It can be in the form of questionnaires, it can be in the form of the interviews. So everything that we have gathered in form of all the documents that we have, this is the physical view. And what is the logical view? The data they contain. The main purpose of a DFT is to communicate with the user, the analyst, understanding of the scope of the required system. Okay. So this is really important that we have an end user and we have multiple stakeholders who have given us lots of requirements, but that is their view of the system, or that is how they do their current activities. Now, when an analyst look at those things, then he would look at in a fashion, because he knows that, you know, this, when it is developed into a computer system, how this should look like. And the scope that you define using a DFD, it might be, you know, you have to convert the physical view into a logical view. So these DFDs, they give you a mechanism to communicate your view to the end user. So where do they fit in of all the life cycle phases? For example, planning, feasibility study, analysis, design, code, and unit test, they basically fall into this analysis, as we already have seen, that when we are trying to analyze the requirements that we have gathered, then, and if we choose this structured approach for analyzing or elaborating requirements, then we are going to use this. One of the things that we can use is make DFDs. So what do we actually do? We investigate business processes and the current system. So this is what we have done. We are modeling the current and required systems. So we have done these things. In our elicitation, we have already have these things. And what do we want from this whole analysis process is requirement specification. All right. And we cannot prepare good specification unless we have, you know, we have conveyed our scope to the client, and we have said, okay, this is what we expect from it. Is this what you want? So to prepare good requirement specification, we deploy these multiple approaches. And as we have talked about this, different object-oriented approaches for analyzing requirements. So we do something similar in flow-oriented modeling, because we want to develop good requirement specification. And in order to do that, we want to create these logical models of the system. So DFDs, they describe the flow of data or information into and out of a system. And what does the system do to the data that we supply it to? So a DFD is essentially is nothing. As I talked about it in our introductory slide, that, you know, a DFD is simply saying that we have inputs and we have our system here, and the system is transforming that, you know, input into an output. So let's try to dive into it. That, you know, there are two things that a DFD does. It decomposes, and it has certain level of abstraction. So when decomposing, a DFD divide and subdivide into manageable size problems. So for example, when I say my learning management system, so a learning management system, it has multiple things happening inside it. So for example, I say learning management system, and to learning management system, there are certain inputs from the students, student inputs, then there are, you know, faculty inputs, and then there are admin inputs. So there are lots of people who are trying to send different kinds of information to my system. Now, this kind of detail is not enough for me, because I would want to know as an analyst that how the student input is recognized that this is a student input, and how an input is distinguished between whether it's a request for checking attendance or whether it's a request for submitting assignment and these kind of things, and how my system is going to handle all these issues. So what do I do is that I try to decompose my system, and I try to subdivide it to manageable size problems, to smaller problems where I can have an understanding that how this is going to be done, and I can convey my understanding to the end user as well. But abstraction is also very important. DFDs, when we're making DFDs, we concentrate on the important issues and ignore the irrelevant. So it is important that we do not go into too much detail, but we rather need to stick to the important issues that we are interested in. There are four main elements when we're making DFDs. There are external entities. People who are external entities, these are people or organizations that send data into the system or receive data from the system. So for example, as I said, in the form of the learning management system, who are the external entities? So in a learning management system, the external entities in the form of people are the student, faculty, and the administration. Similarly, in form of the organization, if we have any suppliers who also have something to do with the learning management system, you know, they are also part of it. And so these, why these entities are important? So the first thing when we are making a DFD, or when we start making a DFD, is to understand that what are the external entities to which my system is going to talk to? or what are the boundaries of my system? If you guys remember when we talked about, when we started talking about object-oriented approach and we were discussing the use cases, we said that we try to identify our system boundary. Okay, so when we are making DFD, it is also very important to understand that, you know, this is my boundary and all the things which are outside and they want to talk to my system, all of these things are called external entities. It can be people or organization. They are trying to send anything to my system and they want to receive anything from my system. Okay, so these are all categorized as external entities. Then what is a process? A process models what happens to the data, that is, transforms incoming data into outgoing data. So for example, you know, if I'm modeling my complete system and saying this is my LMS, then it has this one process where I'm saying that these are the entities which are supplying input to my system and these are the entities which are expecting output from my system, and this is a process which is transforming my input to this particular output. So out of these four elements, we have looked at external entity, we have looked at the process, then we have also data stores. What do these data stores represent? They represent the permanent data that will be used by the system, and it can be in the form of any databases or any information that we are going to store and we are going to access it, for example, student records and faculty records and any kind of this information that we have stored and we are going to access that data again and again. So that is also shown in our DFD, because all we are talking about here is the flow of data, and the data that's coming into the system, we might need to store it somewhere and we might need to access it to process it in form of certain reports. So we need a store. So we also have another element that we show in our DFD, and these are called data stores. And then the most important thing in a DFD is the data flow itself. And these arrows that you can see in they represent the data flows. There are a few things which are very important when we're making a DFD, is that all the processes that we draw, the text that we write in those processes, it should be an action word, because we are trying to say that there is certain action or there is certain transformation would be performed on the data that is coming into this process. And all these data flows, they should indicate that, there shouldn't be any action word here, because it should show that some data is actually coming into this process. So it is very important, you know, these small things are really important when you're making these diagrams, is that if we are not careful, then we are putting in a lot of effort to make these diagrams, but when we'll show it to the user, it will not make sense, because we will be telling him, okay, that this is the input, but if it doesn't read like an input, then somebody who's not familiar, he would say, okay, what are you doing here? And it might cause more ambiguities than actually solving them. So this is very important when we're making these diagrams, be careful about these small things. So let's talk about what is an outside entity. So how do we actually find it? You know, these are the kind of questions that can help us identifying these entities. So is anything outside the system that is of interest to the system? Okay. It can be a person, a company, or another system. So this is a very important question, that there are lots of things outside our system, but there would be few things from which we need to talk to. Because consider a manufacturing company, for example, and we are developing an ERP system for that organization, or implementing an ERP system for that organization, but we want to know that, you know, what are the external entities to this particular organization or to this software that we are going to make. So how do we go about it? That we know that this organization is going to talk to lots of people, and this software might have interaction with lots of people. But so let's say this is my ERP system that I am trying to model. And what I would say, okay, that one external entity would be the end user. So for example, we can say employees. Then maybe, you know, directors would have, you know, different kind of input, and managers might have different kind of input. And then this ERP system, it might talk to as well, it might talk to some suppliers, right? And it might talk to some banks. So the system might generate certain reports, or it might generate certain, you know, invoices that will be sent to the customer as well. So when we are thinking about a system, it is very important to identify these entities carefully. As we said that when we are making a use case diagram, it is very important to identify the actors. So it is very important to identify these entities, because if we miss on some entities, will miss on some key input that would come from, or that would, that some data that needs to be sent to that particular entity. So this is very important, that think about all the things which are outside the system and which are of interest to the system. So for example, customer A, it's an outside entity, it shows the name, and a lowercase alpha character is used to uniquely identify it. So you can write the name of the entity, or you can put certain characters to uniquely identify it. You don't want your diagram to be too complex and having lots of cross links. So what you can do is, if you have to use an external entity twice, and using it twice would mean that you have to cross lots of processes and flows. So you can use this particular symbol where you can have this arrow. You can cut it across the top, which will show that this is the same as this entity. But you're just drawing it again because you don't want to ruin your diagram by making it very complex and having lots of crosslinks. So this is how a data flow is represented. It is shown by a line with an arrowhead indicating the direction of the flow of data. And this is very important. Lots of people, they make this mistake that when they are making DFDs, they do not actually show the flow of data. So this arrowhead actually is indicating that data is flowing from this entity to a process, or between two processes. When we look at particular examples of DFD, you would notice that what happens is that the external entity sent the data to the system. This data is taken as an input by a process. Then this process would transform it in a certain fashion, which would be an input to another process. And this might go an input to another process. And this process might produce an output which is sent to another entity. So it is important to indicate that what is the direction of this flow. And that's why we always put an arrowhead. And as I said, that data flow, it is always named. Okay, and nouns are adjectives only. So when we are writing what kind of information is flowing between information data, or between entity and the process, or between two processes, we always write the name of that data flow. And it should always be a noun or an adjective. It should not be a verb, because a verb would mean that it's a process. Okay, so this is very important to understand, that when we are showing information between two processes, or between an entity and a process, then it's always a noun and an adjective. Then, as I said, that one of the concepts when we make DFDs is decomposition. So this is very important, that we said that one of the things that we do when we're making DFD is that we decompose it. We apply decomposition on the system. And this is very important to understand, because when we're making DFDs, then there are multiple levels of DFDs. And as I said, that when we have gathered requirements from the client, we have lots of user stories, but there is no structure to it. We do not know that at what level of hierarchy this process would come into play. And we have lots of stories and lots of scenarios in front of us. But what DFD does is that it applies decomposition in a hierarchical fashion. So there are multiple levels to our DFD. We start off with the level zero, as I've shown you, that what we have at level zero is external entities sending inputs to my big system, and I am sending some outputs to other external, or the same, or to some external entities. So this is the level zero, or we also call it the context DFD. It's an overview. It contains only one process, which is the main system that we are going to make. Then what we do is that we decompose it further, because, as I said, this understanding is not enough for me, and I have lots of other detail in the user stories and the scenarios that I've gathered in elicitation, and I want to use all that to construct DFDs, and I want to know that how this data is transformed to this output. So what do I do is I decompose it further. So remaining within this system boundary, I want to know that how this input was processed and what other processes are applied on it to produce a certain output. So this is very important for me to understand. And I would apply a certain kind of operations and these kind of things. And only then I would know inside that what's happening in my system. And so these are also processes. So these oval shapes, these are also processes. But we have broken it down from level zero, or the context level, to level one. Okay, so this is the second level of hierarchy. But it may happen that for example, out of these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 processes, there is a process which is which seems that it has too much detail into it. It is at a very high level of abstraction, and there are certain things that we want to know about this process, that how this input is converted into this output. It doesn't make any sense. So what do you do? You say, okay, I'm going to make a level 2 DFD of this particular process. So you will say, okay, this is the boundary of my process, so how do I go about it, that it was taking this one input, and this was the process, and it was producing an output. What are the sub-processes of this process? So I would try to identify all the sub-processes, and I would say, okay, this was the input, this process took the input, it went here, then it went here, and then it went here, and it did something here, and then another process combined them, and then it produced it. So basically, we are saying that until level 1, we have a view which is, at level 1, we also say that at level 1 of the DFD, we have all 4 elements of our DFD, which we talked about. We have processes, we have data flows, we have external entities, and we also try to show data stores. Whereas when we move down to maybe level 2, then at level 2, showing external entities is not important. Okay, because we are only trying to understand particular processes. So when we are making level 2 DFDs, we can make multiple level 2 DFDs, which would respond to multiple processes. For example, as I said, that out of these 5 processes, I made level 2 DFD for this process. I can also make, if this process is complex and I want to know more about it, I will make a level 2 DFD for this process as well. Okay. So there are a few things that we need to be careful about when we are making different levels of DFDs. So let's look at those rules, and then we'll move to the examples of DFDs. So what are the rules? Sequence is not important. Getting the process correct is important when we are making DFDs. So this context or level 0 DFD, it identifies the system boundary and the external links to all the external entities that we have identified. Level 1 is overview of the function. And level 2 is a breakdown to understand. So as I said that, we have level 0, which is just giving us an overview of the system. We have level 1, which is overview of different functions. So we are gaining some functional knowledge about the system. But now we want to know further that, how these processes behave within. So what we do is we apply further decomposition. So normally, it's very hard to know that when to stop, because, hypothetically, you can have up to 9 levels of a DFD. And I've seen systems which were very complex, and we had to make, level 6, level 7 DFDs for certain processes. So it's very difficult to know when to stop. But there is a general rule of thumb which is normally applied, and people say that if we have a process which has 8 or more data flows coming in and out, so it can be anything like that, then we decompose it, because it would mean that it is doing too many things. And we want to know how it is actually dealing with all these inputs and how it is actually producing all these outputs. So it's very hard to know when to stop. But as an analyst, with your experience, you actually come to the point, and this information is not enough, and I need further understanding of it, and you go and you further decompose it. So this is just a general rule of thumb. It's not a rule which you always have to follow. At times, you decompose a process even it has maybe 2 or 3 data flows coming in and out of it. So it's basically it varies from system to system as well. So what's the procedure of constructing a DFD? We draw a document flow diagram of the current situation, draw a system boundary around the agencies that are part of the system, we draw a context diagram, identify processes in the system, and complete the level 1 or the current physical DFD. So just have a quick look at the notations of DFDs, and as we've already seen a couple of the notations, we've already discussed how we show a data flow. So a data flow is a line with an arrowhead which indicates the flow of data. Then a process can be drawn as an oval shape or a circle. It depends on what kind of tool you're using, but normally that's a convention. And external entities are normally drawn as these rectangles or these boxes. And then we also have data stores, where data stores are drawn like that, and you have you write a D here, which actually indicates it's a data store, and you write the name of that data store. And the naming is also important. How do we name these things? A process is always an action word or a verb, whereas we put a noun or a noun clause here, and external entity is always a noun or a noun clause, and then in the data stores, we try to name the DB, where we are database where we are storing information. So what is a level 0 or a context diagram? It models system as one process which represents the scope of the system. And when we say scope of the system, we try to draw a boundary of the system. And anything that is interacting with the system, but which is not part of the system, is essential to the system, but is not part of the system, that is considered as an external entity. And as it says that we identify external entities and related inputs and outputs to those external entities. So what is a level one? We already talked about it. This is overview. It gives a complete overview of the functionality of the system. It identifies the major processes and data flows between them. It also identifies data stores that are used by major processes. Boundary of level one is context diagram. So it is very important. We are going to talk about this in particular when we're making DFDs. It is very important to consider these boundaries, because when we move from level zero to level one, so this is very important to consider these boundaries. So for example, this was my level one, a level zero DFD. And when I move from this level zero to this level one DFD, I need to be very careful, because I know that there is one input to my system and there is an output from my system, and there are these external entities. So when I move to level one, this is the boundary of my level one. So I have this big circle and I have these entities, and this entity was sending an input, but now I have to identify the major sub-processes of this bigger process. So let's say there are two sub-processes, so I identify them. But I need to be very careful that, because I can see in a level zero, in my level zero DFD, there is one input and one output. I need to follow the same thing here, because, and this is also called the balancing of a DFD. So I need to be very careful when I draw boundaries that it should not happen that I have another output going to another external entity, because that would be wrong. So anything that I have in level one, it should be consistent with level zero as well. I can put more information and more detail within the boundary, but I cannot add anything outside the boundary. So this is very important when we're making DFDs. Similarly, when we go to level two, it is a detailed diagram. So we try to identify more processes. We try to gain more insight of particular process at level one. And again, we need to be very, very careful about boundaries. So for example, as I said in the last slide, that for example, this was my level one then. And in this, I said that this input would go to this process and it would produce anything. This would go to this process, and this is how it's going to. So this was the level one. And now I'm saying that I want to know more about this particular process, this process. So this is the boundary of this process. And I can see again that it is producing one input and one output. So I'm going to be very careful now. I'm going to draw, this is the boundary. And let's say this process is what I am interested in. And I'm saying that there are three sub-processes in it. And this was the input, it sent here. And then it sends it here, and then it produces something. Okay. But at level two, it is not necessary to draw the whole diagram again. And again, it is not necessary to draw a level two DFD of all the processes. It depends on the complexity of the system that you are dealing with. And again, as I said, there is no limit to the levels that we can go to. We can also go and go to level three, level four if required. So it depends on the complexity of the product. So there are a few other notations involved in the DFDs. For example, the system boundary, it can be shown. The elementary processes, they can also be indicated with a star in the corner. And processes that is leveled, we can put dots on the top. There are a few other notations which can be used when making DFDs. These are the important rules of DFDs. All the processes in a DFD, they are always numbered. Because remember, I said that this is a hierarchical structure, because we have processes in different hierarchies and we are trying to put information in a certain structure. Okay? And so we have some numbering rules, we have some labeling rules, and we also have some balancing rules. Okay? So let's look at numbering first. So because we have only one process at level zero, so we don't actually number that process, because it makes sense that we have only one process. And let's say this is my level one DFD, so I don't need to number this process, because there is just one process. And again, then I have, for example, when I make level one DFD of this process, I would have multiple processes within it. And I want to know that which process I'm talking about, because I might further decompose this process into a level 2 process. So that's why numbering is important. So I would number all the level 1 processes as 1, 2, 3, 4, and these numbers are unique because we want to keep track of these processes. And when we make, let's say we make a level 2 DFT of this process 2. So for this process we are making a level 2. So all the sub-processes within this process level 2, we number them 2.1, 2.2, 2.3. So again, something which I should mention, that these numbers, they are just there to uniquely identify these processes. They do not represent any order of processing, because it's not saying that 1.1 would occur first and then 1.2 would occur. Okay. And when I said that, you know, DFDs are there to put structure to the whole information that we gather in elicitation, by no way I mean that, you know, when we are showing these processes then and we are drawing them in certain hierarchy, it does not represent any order of processing. It tells us that when this process would be executed, what other processes might be executed. Okay. So the numbering, it is only there to uniquely identify those processes. Their order of processing across multiple processes is not the purpose of this numbering. And if you have multiple data stores, as we said that there is another entity which you can have in DFDs, which are data stores. And I said that normally data stores are represented with this kind of rectangle, and you put a D there. If you have multiple data stores, then you also number them D1. And you can number them D2. It should indicate that there are multiple data stores. Okay, so labeling is also very important. We've already talked about it, that how do we label a process. We said it's normally a verb or an action word, and it should actually describe what the process is about. For example, if your process actually deals with the order of a price, then you can name it price order. And similarly, you also label your data flows. And we said that all the labels of a data flow, they should be nouns or adjectives. So for example, a customer payment can be a data flow. And then you have data store label. It describes the type of data store. So this is all you wanted. If you have a store specifically for storing student information, you will say student data store. Or if it for example, you are making an inventory management system and you're storing inventory, it should say inventory management system. All the labels, they should be as meaningful as possible, because remember we said that this is an analyst representation of the system, and you want it to share with the user. Okay, you want to tell him, okay, that this is how I believe when it is those real world practices of yours are computerized, this is how I think your system would look like. So all the labels, they should be as meaningful as possible. This is very important, and we briefly talked about it. Balancing, any data flow, how do we define this balancing? Any data flows entering or leaving a parent level must be equivalent to those on the child level. So this is very important, and I'm quickly going to talk about them again. That, for example, as I said that, you know, let's say this is my level 1 and this is what's happening in my level 1. So I had one input to this process and two outputs from this process. Okay, and I've numbered them 1, 2, 3, but I want to draw a level 2 DFD of this process number 1. So I say level 2 process 1, level 2 DFD of process 1. Okay. So when I'm going to draw it, I'm going to be very careful that, let's say these are the sub processes of that, and I have 1.1, 1.2, 1.3. Now I need to be very careful that the data flows that are going in and out of this, they should remain the same. So it should not happen that I have 4 data flows coming or going out. So the number of input inflows and the number of outflows, it should be the same in a parent and the child. Okay, so this is what balancing is about. And where to put data store? We said that, you know, your DFDs can have multiple data stores, but if a data store is not relevant to a particular process, we do not need to show it. So just remember that only show a data store if it is relevant to a certain process. For example, we might have our data store here, which actually shows that, you know, this level 2 actually sends something to this data store, okay, and it gets something back from it. So, but this is not relevant to level 1. We do not need to show it when we create a level 2 DFD of this process 1. So this is very important, that data stores that are local to a process, need not to be included until the process expands. So this is also very important that if there is a certain data store which is only local to process one and which was not required in this level, in this particular level, and there is a data store which is only relevant to this process number one, we might show it here. So we might put another data store two, and we would say that this was only local to this particular process. So those were the those are the few rules and multiple levels of DFDs that we have discussed. Now let's quickly look at an example, because again, as a requirement analyst, that is what I am interested in knowing, that how from set of user stories or how from set of scenarios I will move to making a DFD. Now I've seen that how I go about making a DFD. Let's quickly look at an example and try to visualize that when an analyst are given a certain set of scenarios or he has certain user stories, how he transforms that real world practices into this logical view. So for example, you know, let's say this is the same text that we used when we are doing object oriented analysis, and in that we saw that how we identify classes by identifying different nouns in it and how we identify different attributes and different operation of classes. Now this similar text, this can again, or this is what we have. So we will, if we are applying structured analysis, we'll again use this text, and our goal is now to identify operations in this text. And it is very similar to when we try to identify different operations, we'll try to identify all the verbs in it. Okay, so for example, we'll do the safety home security function. The safe home security function, it enables the homeowner. So enables is a process. To configure is again a process. The security, when it is installed, monitors all the sensors. So monitoring is a process, because when we are saying it is monitoring, it is taking some input, and depending on, you know, what the sensor is sensing, it produces an output. So monitoring is again a process. So what we do is we read the text, we do a grammatical parse, we identify all the action words in it, and all the action words are used to identify the processes of the system. So let's say this is the level one or the level zero or the context DFD of that, again the same example that we have been covering in this analysis, which is a safe home software. So we know what that external entities of the system are, because we know that what my system does is that it has a control panel, which I know it's an external entity, because the user he will be trying to sending some information through this control panel. Then there are some sensors deployed, and there would be input to my system via those sensors. And then I know that there is a small display panel on the control, the display on the control panel, where certain output are being shown to the user. And so I put that as also an external entity. Then I know that alarm would be sound based on certain output from my system and based on certain input that I got from these sensors. So based on these inputs, I might need to sound an alarm. And alarm would go to which external entity? Alarm. And then I have, based on those certain triggers, I have another output which I need to make certain phone calls, and those phone calls would go to this telephone line, which is also an external entity. So again, if we look at this example, that none of the external entities is actually a person. Okay, so there are lots of devices here. So for example, we have control panel, we have sensors, we have control panel display, alarm, telephone. So it is very important to understand that, you know, a user is going to interact with my system through this control panel. So I didn't put the user there. And again, if you remember from our object-oriented analysis, this is what was common there as well. We did not include homeowner as a information domain class. So this is very important. If you try to remember our previous lecture, when we were identifying classes, then information domain classes. And if you remember, we said that control panel would be a class because it was satisfying all those criteria, and we did not put homeowner as a class because we said that we do not need to store information about the homeowner. Okay, and because if there are multiple people living in the house, they will all be using the control panel in a similar fashion. So we do not need to know which particular person is actually dealing with the control panel. So, but control panel is important because this is used to send input to my system. So again, remember that anything which is outside the system boundary and it is important to my system, that is an external entity. So I am not putting that a homeowner is here, because he is not going to send anything useful here, because everything that is done is through this control panel. And the other source of input to my system are the sensors. Okay. And then there are certain output, which is one output is to the control panel display, then there is output to the alarm, and then output to the telephone line. So at level zero, identifying process is the easiest bit, okay, because you know the name of your software. So that is just the main process that you have. So the complexity or the important thing that we need to be very careful about when we are analyzing our requirements is that when we read the text, it is important to identify that what are the external things which will send some information to my system, or what are the things which are expecting something from my system. So if we look back at this text, then we can actually see that the safe home security function enables the homeowner to configure the security system. So we know that homeowner is going to configure the system when it, and we also know that, you know, the system is actually monitoring some sensors, right? And the security system, it interacts with the homeowner through this control panel. So again, I know that, so I've identified a couple of external entities by identifying different processes. So we know that, you know, monitoring would be a process, and it would be applied to the input that is taken from the sensors. Similarly, I know that my security system, it would interact with the homeowner, and the interaction, for the interaction, what my system is going to use, a control panel. Okay. Similarly, during the installation, the safe home PC is used to program and configure the system. Each sensor is assigned a number and type. A master password is programmed for arming and disarming the system. And the telephone numbers are input for dialing when a sensor event occurs. So I know that, you know, there are these telephone numbers, which is a kind of data, and we need to do some dialing based on some sensor event. So we know that, you know, there would be an external entity which would be to which this output would go to, that which number to call. And so we need to actually look further into that to actually identify. And as you guys saw that in the context, we said that telephone 9 would be another external entity. Similarly, when a sensor event is recognized, the software invokes an audible alarm. So we know that, you know, there is a process which invokes alarm. Okay, and alarm is not in my system, this is outside my system, but it uses output, or it is waiting for the output from my system, so that is another external entity. So this is how we actually go about it. We have lots of user stories, you read it once to identify your processes, you read it again to identify different data, and you read it again to identify, you know, who is interested in actually getting this data from my system, or who is sending this information to my system, and that is how you identify those external entities. And as I said, when we are making context DFD, the most important and the most difficult thing is to identify these external entities. And it is important that we do not miss on any external entity, because if we do so, it would mean that we have missed on some very important data flow to and from my system. So again, this is the decomposition of that context DFD into a level 1 DFD. And if you remember the things that we talked about the rules and about the numbering, then one of the rules which was there in a DFD is that a DFD should be balanced. Now let's try to draw the boundary of this DFD. Now if we say that this is the boundary of my DFD, then how many data inflows and outflows you can actually see in, you know, outside this boundary? So there is this one data flow, second, third, fourth, and fifth. So there are five. In total, there are two inflows and three outflows, so there are five data flows. And if we go back and look at our context DFD, so how many data flows are there? There is this 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So it also has 5. So we can see that our level 1 DFD is balanced. But one thing that is missing here is we said that we need to number our processes. So we need to do something. We need to number all of them. So we say this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4, this is 5, and this is 6. So again, this numbering is not important. I can number this 6, this 5, 4, and, you know, this numbering is not important, because I'm not trying to emphasize that this is the order in which these processes would be executed. I'm just trying to uniquely identify these processes. And we have this data store here, which is represented by this D, and because it says this is a data store. So let's see how I went about decomposing it, because If we go back and look at the text again, then we saw that, you know, how a homeowner interacts with my system. Okay, it interacts with the system through a control panel. So, and at at level 0, we said that control panel is used to send the user commands and data. So I know that I need a process which needs to understand that what kind of input is being sent to me. Okay. So I have this process which says interact with the user, and I try to identify what kind of input it is. So whether it's a password, whether it's a configuration request, or whether the user is trying to request is requesting for the device to stop or start. So there can be multiple kind of inputs that a user might send. So I want a process which actually distinguishes that what kind of input it is. So I'm saying that I need a process which interacts with the user inputs and understand that what is that input. And based on that, this process produces three possible types of data. Either if it's a password, then the flow would come here. If it's a configuration request, then the flow would go here. And if it's a start-stop request, the flow would come here. Now, it is very important to, again, establish here that if the user is requesting for a password change, then although we have numbered it as process 4, but this is the second thing that is being executed. So as I said, this numbering is just for uniquely identifying processes. It does not tell us the order of processing. Okay, so if it is a request for password change, so I'm saying that new password will be supplied, and I have another process which processes the password. If it's valid, then a display message is sent to the user. And how you send it, we have a process, because there are multiple things that we want to show to the user. For example, if he says that I want to change my password, then I want to show him some information. If he says that I want to activate or deactivate the alarm, we want to show him something. If he is configuring the system, I want to show him some information or give him some information. So I need a process which actually handles the output from my system to the control panel. So I have made a process which decides what kind of output I need to show to the user, and this is used to deal with this particular output. And I am connecting this to this particular process which processes the password, then this process which activates and deactivates the alarm. And what is the data? The data is the activation message. Okay, and that is, again, this data would be sent to the control panel in the form of this display information. Similarly, if the user sends the request for configuration, then we have a process which actually configures the system. So we say configure system is a process, and what is the output of this process is the configuration data. Okay, for example, the user sets the automatic times when the system should start and stop. Okay, so that is some change in the configuration, and the configuration data might include that the system should start at 8 p.m. and it should stop at 7 a.m. or whatever the user decides. But this configuration data, we need to store it somewhere. Okay, because our system is going to look at it again and again. So we need a store where we are saving this configuration data, and we also want to show these configuration settings to the user. So we are saying that this configuration data will also be sent to the display message and status process, which is then sent back to the control panel display. So we have all these processes, they are dealing with the user commands. Okay, what user is trying to send to the system and how our system is going to respond to it. But another important thing that we are missing right now is the other input, which was to my system. So another main input to my system was coming from the sensors. And what was the input that I'm interested in is the sensor status, or the values that these different sensors are sending. So this sensor status is sent to this process, and the process name is monitor sensors. Okay, and this process is actually monitoring as I said, that when we discussed this particular product in our previous lectures as well, that there may be multiple type of sensors involved. So this is quite a complex process, because we are saying monitor sensors, and depending on multiple types of sensors, we might have, you know, different kind of processing involved. So we are saying that we have this process, because remember, we are just trying to identify the main processes, because this is just the level 1 of this DFD. And the sensor information would be displayed on the control panel. So we are saying that this sensor information in the form of data would go to this display process, which would send it to the control panel display. But based on the values of different sensors, we have to either invoke the alarm and we have to send a message to the telephone lines. So we'll say that we will we'll tell to our alarm bell that if it's a fire, then sound a certain type of alarm. But if it's somebody breaks in, sound a different type of an alarm. And similarly, if it's fire, then I will tell my telephone line that call the fire station. And if somebody is broken in, then call maybe the police. So we look at the input to the system and we try to further understand, we try to further decompose that, okay, how this input would be handled by system. And again, I use the text in the form of scenarios and user stories that I've gathered in elicitation. Now, if we look at this level 0 and level 1 DFD, I will just try to summarize because we are almost approaching the end of the lecture. So I will just try to summarize what we have done today. And again, remember, as an analyst, what we were interested in was to understand the behavior and functionality of the system. So what we have done here is that we had this user stories and the scenarios that we have gathered during elicitation, and user told us that, you know, the homeowner would try to send certain commands to the system using a control panel, and our system is monitoring sensors, and depending on the sensor input, there are certain alarm might be sound, or there certain calls would be made, and you know, these kind of things. So we have all these user stories. But now we want to know, okay, that this is the real life view, and I want to understand that how these things would be implemented, so how logically these things would be done. So I said, okay, let's put some structure to this information. So I said, okay, these are the external entities which are sending some information to me, and I want to know how this information is handled. And this is how you start making a DFD. You identify those external entities, you identify those inputs, and you identify those outputs again. So based on the inputs, you say, okay, when I will make level 1 DFD, I will look at these inputs one by one. So I look at the first input and I said, okay, user command and data. So this is, I know from my user story that was one of the input, that user is going to interact with my system through control panel. But now I need to decide as an analyst that how this input would be handled within the system. And I know from the scenario that it said that user, that there might be a process which says interacting with the user. And I know from different scenarios that what kind of things the user can do. So I know he can change the password, I know he can change the configuration settings, I know he can activate and deactivate the system. So based on that, I say that whenever a user is interacting with the system, he can send these three kind of informations. So I have put more structure to my information. And I said, okay, but I need to display, or I need to give certain feedback to the user as well. Okay, so I made another process. And similarly, I started looking at the other input to my system, which was sensor status. And based on it, I said, okay, I need a process which actually deals with the input from the sensors. And based on the input, it produces certain outputs. And what are the outputs? The output go to this process, and there are two outputs which are going to the external entities. So again, we can see that, you know, this structured analysis, how this is useful for an analyst to analyze and elaborate on the requirements that we have gathered during the elicitation stage. So that is it from today's lecture. In the next lecture, we'll continue with this example. We try to finish it, and we'll try to finish our topic on flow-oriented modeling and structured analysis. And we'll try to conclude elaboration process as well. So take care, and Allah Hafiz. Assalamu alaikum.